to do is set up a couple things.
Oh, this is gonna
work too well. Well, I'll try this first.
So synthetic clouds. They're not synthetic, it's actually sort of a piece of artwork for film. And I have this damn playlist. I'm kind of random, so.
let me
see. Yeah. I want something that's not going to distract me too much as I talk, but anyway, these clouds are based on satellite imagery, but it was kind of put together artistically to have kind of a layer of clouds. What I want to do is actually bring up sort of yesterday's image, a global mosaic that's prepared by several satellites. If we go around the night side, we will see that those clouds are sort of baked in along with the city lights. So I usually do a couple things here. I'm going to make the Earth nighttime a lot darker. And so we have all the planets and their various positions and times and stuff based on NASA's navigational files, a system called SPICE. And so what I want to do is actually call up sort of yesterday's global mosaic. And the reason I'm going to bring it up today is that today's will likely not quite be finished. So, because once the images come in, they have to be prepared. It takes a few hours, then they're posted. But NASA is creating a kind of a global image daily. This didn't exist when I started here 19 years ago. The data did, it was on the ground, but the services were not really set up to kind of put them out. And certainly on the web at that time. So let me see. Okay. So make sure I get the right thing here. Let's see. Actually, I'm going to do another search here. The modules here that the astronauts live in, the closest one to us right here is the Columbus module from the European Space Agency, is about 15 feet in diameter. And that's the that's basically the dimension of the cargo bay of the space shuttle, which brought most of this up. The first two components were brought up by the Russians, Zarya and Vesta. So I will, let's see, I'll move up over the hex beam here, components of which were brought up by the space shuttle.
I feel like Sandra Bullock.
What's that?
I feel like Sandra Bullock in Gravity.
Yeah, there you go. we were quite honored to for our last production to be nominated from the Visual Effects Society.
So Sandra got up. Of course, they won. They were winning all sorts of awards and Gravity that year, but Sandra was up at the podium. So didn't get to meet her per se, but it was kind of fun to hang out in Hollywood. So here's the Russian equipment, Zarya and Zvezda, and the first two modules launched, and of course the Soyuz, which we used to now get up. And I have set the time such that we see the Earth going by below. It's going by at 1 second per second. It seems kind of slow and stately, kind of like looking out the airplane of a window, but we're a lot higher. We're 250 miles up as opposed to 8 miles at 40,000 feet. We usually fly even below that, but at this speed, the space station goes around the Earth in 90 minutes. So the astronauts get a sunrise and a sunset every 45 minutes. And if we come in close enough, we can actually kind of make the Soyuz actual size. So
So they actually, when they're launched, they're up here in the spherical section. And I'll show you where I would hang out, certainly, if I was there. I would want to be in the cupola, which is aimed so that it's always observing the Earth. And that's the sort of bay window. And we respectfully have the windows shuttered at the moment. They actually have these big pads over the windows. These windows are sort of weak spots in the space station. So they don't have a lot of windows, unfortunately, but this area they do. And you've probably seen pictures from this cupola right here, which is nice. So it's sort of Earth focused. This is a model, thanks to NASA, but actually built by my colleagues in Japan, who optimized it for use with this software, so it's nice and smooth as I fly around it. The Earth is jiggling a little bit. And then this is the Japanese experiment module. Actually, there are two modules and this, what they call the porch. And so all of this in here is the Japanese equipment. And somewhere in here is the flag of Japan. Maybe just on this border between the light from the sun and the adapter inside the cargo bay. And so on the flight deck, looking opposite the astronauts when they land the shuttle, and looking back into the cargo bay, basically command the shuttle flying it in like this to a docking. You can see the handholds in front of us. Human scale. Once again, the diameters here of the module is about 15 feet. And so, from Earth and from here, let's move out. Don't want to do it too fast. You see Antarctica in this winter lighting, and just about here, continue rotating around. Actually, I'm rotating around the space station, so what I should do before the Earth hits us in the face is I'm going to say, please center on Earth. So now I'm just going to move it to the center, allow me to move around the Earth rather than around the space station. We have Australia coming up. And what I'll do now is turn on the Earth's magnetosphere. This is the result of a simulation during a period of solar activity when we were being bombarded by what's called the Halloween storm of 2003 during a period of solar maximum. And I show it just because it's a rather beautiful looking thing, if we in fact could see it. So this is, once again, this UniView software, but we were funded by NASA to actually develop new software that allows us to look more at the process of the universe. UniView was basically designed to allow us to go through the different scales of the universe, starting from Earth and go all the way out, and I'll take you out there. The new software is about sort of showing dynamic simulations, and so we can do a lot more with something like this, the Earth's magnetosphere. So we did a presentation fairly around a magnet show kind of symmetry. Earth, if it was not sort of caught in the flow of the solar wind, this would probably look like a donut around Earth, pinching in poles. This magnetosphere is blown back essentially into the magnetotail, and it reaches out to the dimensions of about the moon's orbit. So now we're seeing the moon here. That's a 250,000 miles out into space. And if we want to look at the moon, I can do that. In fact, I had to reset time for this period in December, so this is not respecting where the moon is today, but that's okay. And now, target the moon. We'll move the moon to the middle. And I just want to make sure before we do that, I'm going to, let's see. I'm going to set up one of NASA's maps, so I'm going to do that before I get there. That looks good. And we're set to go for the moon. The moon should be about third quarter. And as we approach, it'll look a bit dark. And also, our techniques in this rendering are not exactly as nice as I would like them to be, so what I'm going to do is just turn on a headlight for us so we can see the whole moon. This will allow us to see this map much better. And took the Apollo astronaut 3-4 days to reach the moon. We cover the distance of 250,000 miles in our orbit around the sun in about 4 hours. So between the time you wake up in the morning and the time that you had lunch, basically covered this distance. Now I'm going to just approach the moon slowly for us. And a couple of features. This is Copernicus. This is Tycho crater down here. This is Mare Imbrium, the Sea of Rains, the Ocean of Storms, the Sea of Serenity, and the Sea of Tranquility. And right down here in our Ritter, and just east of Ritter and Sabine is Apollo 11's landing site. Apollo 17 up here in Taurus Littrow, but my favorite one is Apollo 15 up here in Talus Putridinus. Stands for the Putrid Swamp. It's the name of their landing site. Of course, NASA didn't want to say that too much, so they concentrated on a nicer name, Hadley Rill, because of Hadley Rill running through there. Let's come down and see what this rill business is. A rill is actually sort of a collapsed lava tube or a lava channel, and we can see it emanating here from what they call the Cobra Head. And then it sort of sinuously winds its way across the moon. And, interesting. This is what Mars really looks like. We have been working hard to make this come together. You can still see there's a little hippity hop and what's going on with, it's not completely smooth. I may be able to tailor that as well. But this does allow us to get in over this terrain, which has been highly eroded by the winds, but it looks almost like wood. Like wood grain. These are the fine sediment stuff. And we can also see that they're sulfate rich, which is like gypsum, kind of like evaporate salt deposits that we see in dry lake beds on Earth. Now let me see if I can make this a little less taxing on us, a little smoother in operation. Was that you guys?
It's time to get your quarters back from Pac-Man. The new Pac-Man scratch-off from the...
back to the ads.
Yeah, that was. That was us.
You're set, Tim. But
yeah, that was all us, pretty much.
Yeah. I, The last song is one of my favorites. I can't remember the name of it.
I think that's Shanghai Surf.
Yeah, Shanghai
Surf. That's why you like it.
I always have to look back at the damn name, but I love that song. Wow. So great. My nephew is here, and he's a big Star Wars fan. And he said when I zoomed in on this, he half expected some little ships to go zooming by. But this is
more ominous because it's real.
Yeah. And so here, I'll let it fly a little bit this way. I'll turn it, and when it turns around, or I'll turn it around, but I'll come out there and lay down with you guys to enjoy it, because over here where I'm flying, it's really sort of distorted because I'm over at the edge of the dome. Hopefully in the not too distant future, we'll have controls that will allow me to, like some previous software and like the stuff I was initially flying before I tried to bring this up, it used to have some remote control capabilities. I will point out that the height of this is probably about the height of a 50-story building. So we're looking at the hills here are generally about 100 meters, 300 feet, 500 feet. Maybe a 50-story building or so. So I think it's sort of, you know, downtown city skyscrapers, but I guess some of the tallest ones here would be maybe about 1,000 feet, or about the height of the Freedom Tower of World Trade Center. So I'll turn us around. What I really want to get, so they would be fantastic. But if you're in one of these hangars, you know, here is Antares, is like Mars. This is Saturn over here, but red like Mars. It's a red giant about 300 light years away. And so we now see Venus and, there's Mars and should be Mercury. They're moving back and forth here, but to get a sense, gotta go farther out, and I believe we've got Jupiter, over here as well. So let's move back. Oh, actually, before that, the Sun, in going through the zodiac, I can turn on the zodiacal constellations. Light years out, it's called the Hyades star cluster. Let's move out a little farther. We should also see within the constellation Taurus another grouping, the Pleiades, right here. And they're about 400 light years away. So, light from a period of when Galileo first started using his telescope. So, if you were here and saw us, we'd see us 400 years ago, and we're seeing them 400 years ago. Speed of light issue. So how big is the galaxy? Well, let's move out now. And we're now seeing the Milky Way galaxy depicted in two ways. One is an image of a galaxy that's somewhat like the Milky Way, and then also this volumetric model, which is a little cartoony, but it also helps illustrate the fact that we don't really have a great picture of our Milky Way because we're inside it. We did our best job in our space show to use a simulation from the Japanese, which is constrained to what we can measure in radio, where gas and dust clouds are that are birthing stars and things like that. But suffice to say, in gross terms, we are halfway out on the radius of a galaxy that's 100,000 light years across. We're about 26,000 light years from the center. And like all the other stars around us, we're all going around and we make an orbit just as the Earth does. Dust actually absorbs light optically. That's why we saw it dark across the center. But here we are. We can use the zodiacal constellations are all really in close to us. This is our solar neighborhood. And but it takes us 250 million years to make one orbit. And we've been around for about 5 billion years. The sun is that old. Has enough fuel for about 5 billion more. In 250 million years, we'd have to go four times around for 1 billion years. So we've been going around the galaxy for about 18 to 20 turns. 20 since the sun formed, maybe 18 since the Earth formed, whoever's counting. But if you think about this, last time we were here, going this direction, last time we were here, that life was really just crawling out of the ocean. Fauna were crawling out of the ocean. A billion years before that, perhaps land had been pioneered by plants. But the beginning of the Triassic, and then the Jurassic, and finally the Cretaceous, and one quarter turn back out of 20 times around the galaxy, the dinosaurs died off. So they're really not that long in the past. And also that radiosphere, which is all practically invisible now that I showed you, that once again, it's about 75 light years. I'll just come back close enough where you can see it. 75 light years in radius, kind of hard to see. Let's see, when do we get to see it? This dust blocks our view. Let's see. Ah, now you can just see that bluish bubble. So the diameter is 150 light years. 75 light years is just this. And you might wonder, well, okay, at this speed that we're orbiting the galaxy, how long does it take us to go one light year? Well, the answer is 2,000 years for one light year. So if the radius of this is 75 light years, it would take us 150,000 years. The length of time that Homo sapiens have walked on the planet just to go the radius of that radiosphere. Once again, a little closer to see it. And so if you want to, well, that's the Orion Nebula floating by in foreground, right there. I just happen to get close to it. That the length of time that people have even been on the planet is really just our sun going from here to here, which is truly extraordinary as we back away and consider that, you know, 150,000 years, Homo sapiens on the planet, the first hominids really about 2 million years ago. The distance of Andromeda Galaxy is about 2 million light years away. The Magellanic Clouds that I pointed out earlier are 150,000 light years away, so we see them in the southern hemisphere from an epoch of really the first humans as we know them walking around. And now what we see is an accounting of galaxies. Each one is a real charted data point. These are not stars. Every one of these is from a galaxy like us. Every one of these points is several hundred billion stars. Every one of these points is perhaps several trillion worlds. So as we pull away into the galaxies, we should be able to see at some point another little galaxy. These are minor galaxies, these reddish dots around us. We should see at some point, let's see, Andromeda Galaxy, which is about 2 million light years away from us. Okay, I missed it there, but that's okay. We'll keep going. There's also kind of a band through here. This represents where the Milky Way blocks our view of looking for galaxies, although we can see a strand here that continues here. So we know that there are galaxies in there, we just have trouble observing them. And of course, now going farther out, we see deeper surveys, which, by the way, are incomplete in their coverage of sky. They have not covered the entire sky, and but what they have covered is pretty amazing. And these surveys are sort of ongoing, but this is the Sloan Digital Sky Survey. The color coding in close, so the galaxies we've been flying around, red is sort of the dense clusters and so forth. But as we go farther out, the color is sort of akin to density. And so we have on screen now about a million galaxies. Let's pull out farther. And from the Sloan Digital Sky Survey, and there's another group in here, the 2-degree field. And if we recall for a moment, that gap I was showing earlier, am I still pulling out? I want to make sure I'm not. I only get to the microwave background so quick. Here we go. One of my buttons is not working, But what we do see in close, sometimes it's hard to see with too many galaxies, like a cloud, but we can see there's a lumpiness distribution. That's called the large-scale structure of the universe. And we see that that is evident farther and farther out as we go. And then these are high redshift, far distant galaxies in the formation process, quasars. Again, the artifacts of the surveys just having bands instead of something more consolidated. The difference being this is a southern hemisphere, and the northern hemisphere had more resources of completing more of the survey. But once again, this area where we have no data is where the Milky Way creates a kind of shadow in coverage, where it's just hard to distinguish between a dim galaxy and a dim star. And of course, Hubble found the whole thing was expanding. And the farther out we look, the faster it is expanding. This is this red shift that we see, a Doppler effect in light. And we use that as a hedge to actually get true distance. And that distance to expansion rate is called the Hubble law. And now just backing into, you've seen the merge a couple times, but the microwave background. Where it's red, it's hotter than the blues, although that temperature variation is extremely small. And here it's exaggerated so that we can see it. But we now know that these slight temperature variations are what give rise to the lumpiness of the large-scale structure of the universe, which we see much closer to us in time, an evolved universe, whereas this is kind of a baby picture of the universe is essentially we're enslaved within it. It's kind of our horizon in time and space. Just because it's taken light the age, pretty much almost the age of the universe to reach us. Not entirely the age of the universe. In fact, the radiation was released about 300,000 years after the Big Bang. The universe was so hot that it was opaque for 300,000 years, and then finally it was, they cooled off in the expansion enough to kind of freeze this latent image that we see. Now, if we were a distant quasar, we would see us in the ancient past, and you would have a giant sphere sort of centered around you, and you would see farther in one direction than we can see, and we can see farther in the other direction. Everyone, no matter where you're observing, is going to be limited to this kind of horizon that we see. So if you're out here, you'd see sort of a sphere around you. You'd see more in this direction. We see more in this direction. We don't know how big the universe is. It could be infinite. We can extrapolate from the Hubble Deep Field, the picture that they took several hundred hours in a part of sky that from the ground we couldn't see one galaxy. Well, they saw thousands of galaxies. They were launching James Webb Space Telescope, I think in 2019, on a European rocket. And hopefully that will be successful and we'll be able to reach much deeper than Hubble. But still contained within, this is our visible portion of the universe. And again, we don't know if the universe, how much bigger is the universe from our sample, perhaps small sample of the universe. You can extrapolate from the Hubble Deep Field that there are several, or perhaps one to several hundred billion galaxies within this view. And I like to kind of look at this map of these galaxies. And, you know, if they are truly worlds and life, that you think of them as galaxies, but they're also, they're mapping locations, places that could easily be other eyes looking out at the universe, other eyes perhaps looking back at us and wondering if there's any other life out there just the same way that we do. But this is the picture that's been put together amazingly and within about the last 20 years. We started off in 1998 having discussions about the first show with only 3,500 galaxies. Now we have over 2 million. And that's thanks to modern methods of computing to help design the telescopes, analyze the data, and then plot it. And so I really feel that this room was designed to show this picture. This picture is coming together, the capabilities of displaying what you see here were just coming together at the turn of the millennium, which is really when this automation of the astronomical research really took off. This is Andromeda, an M33, and this is Milky Way. Andromeda is about the same size, so that's about 2 million light years. Light from Australia, about the time Australopithecus would walk around in Africa, and now coming back in. Light from the center of the galaxy 26,000 years ago. Think of cave art being preserved that we were up to back then. Of course, some cave art maybe 40 to 50,000 years old. But really agriculture about 10,000 years ago, the creation of bread and the ability to store grain and create cities and trade, culminating now in the ability to map the universe and convey that across the world. So this software, which was which is the basis of this company that my former students created, have enabled this in a lot of planetariums around the world. Also, we license this data set, which we pulled together from academic sources, but it's a lot of work to put all that together. We license that to top vendors of planetarium gear around the world, And so that this sort of journey through this data and what it means has sort of become a mainstay in the planetarium world, just like the old star projectors were. Here's the Big Dipper. It's reformed since we've come home. There's the North Star and the Little Dipper up here as we are careening rapidly back home. The outer solar system, the Voyagers, the Pioneers. These are zodiacal constellations, the exoplanets, the Earth's latitude and longitude system stretched out into space. Coming back to a planet close enough to its star to be warm, not too far to be too cold. It's the only planet we know of that has liquid water as a surface. We're finding a lot of water in the outer solar system in the form of ice, and also as oceans buried under some of that ice, in the case of Europa and Jupiter, Enceladus and Saturn. And finally, we make out lunar orbit, the farthest we've ever been out into space, and then coming home to Earth. And once again, we're spinning about 12 hours per second in that case. I'll slow that down. One hour per second. And I'll go to 1 minute per second, and we'll seem to just stop. Okay. So if anybody asks you how fast you're going, just sitting in a chair, you can tell them, well, you know, if I'm sitting at the equator, I'm going 1,000 miles an hour. The Earth is 8,000 miles in diameter times pi, at the circumference, 24,000 miles, and we go around 24 hours. But we're actually going about 20 miles per second around the sun. We're going 5 times that speed around the galaxy. We're going about 100 miles per second. And at that speed, it takes us 2,000 years to go one light year, which is pretty extraordinary. So, that's been fun to show you this tonight. And I'll just perhaps bring up the red lights now.